viral. Philadelphia Eagles running back Corey Clement has made the journey from undrafted rookie to Super Bowl 52 hero. And now he may have a new title after this. Take a look.
Not often we get a Super Bowl champion weather forecaster from today.
I don't know when it's going to rain, but it's going to rain today.
Welcome to the club.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Before the day is through, we'll see some rain. Behind us is Ultimate Doppler Radar. You want to take a look? I can step out.
Oh.
And look, there you
Ooh.
Go. Look. See?
Today, what is that, Wilmington?
Now you're, right?
Oh.
See, Philadelphia's right there.
Oh, yeah, this is
you
very
can see
cool.
It right there.
Williamsport,
that's so fun.
Look at how everything is just traveling to the east.
Right.
And down here on the Philadelphia area.
Right, there you go.
The clouds are moving that way. And
it looks like
New York is not getting anything. So shout out to New York.
Shout out to New York.
And
right.
Philadelphia, you guys are going to be in for a little bit of rain tonight. So it's all good. Everybody stay inside. It's all good.
Wait, we just have to explain to people at home that don't know how TV works. When there's a weather map behind you,
they know it's reverse.
It is reverse onto a green screen. So what he's looking at is nothing. Basically, he has to find it.
Don't make excuses for this.
I am making excuses. It is not easy.
Stop making excuses for this man.
Nick.
CeCe, this guy is out here living your dream. This guy is out here. Doubling
and
as.
And what dream is that?
Be a meteorologist.
Can be a double life as a weather
reporter.
Because it's definitely not being on television without a wardrobe person. Like with my ripped jeans on and my hat on back. Like, did he think he was going on TV?
I knew it. You were going to come at Corey Clement's throat on this. You want to listen?
No, I was just a little concerned, too, that he didn't know what the jet stream was. That's what goes from west to east. I mean, I guess they don't teach that at Wisconsin. I mean, just some of the basics.
Here
I was trying to come out and be nice and explain that it's hard to do that.
People know it's
hard
to do
that. And you guys just shot him down.
There is no doubt. What about the meteorologist? She just set him up. Oh, I'm out of here.
Yeah. Can I listen to our friends in the local New York media, whether it be New York One, any of the local stations, if we could do a one-day Chris Carter weather fantasy camp, I will pay top dollar to make that.
What about
happen.
Right here at Fox?
And I will, our local Fox
right
affiliate, whatever it is. Chris, first of all, would not be confused about the left, right, right,
left. I bet you'd be a little bit
he
confused.
Would,
it's not easy. I bet you he would. It's just he's a smart man and he's very well dressed. I bet you it would confuse him.
Jenna,
I say this with all due respect. No, you don't. You never do.
Just because it confused
Stop
you
it. Stop
when you tried to do it,
you know what,
doesn't
Nick,
mean
it
it's
would
hard
probably
for
be
everybody.
Hard for you too. All right, we're moving on, apparently.
I think I've done more difficult things.
I would imagine
career.
So.
On an island, as always.
Left is right, right is left. How do you figure it out?
I can't with you. I literally cannot.
Is that the primo
you.
Job as a broadcaster? Is
oh,
that
guys.
During the weather?
All right. Or? Here we go. 76ers fans. Serious story now. Stop laughing.
Oh.
Sixers fans held their breath last night as Joel Embiid left the game against the Knicks with a facial contusion after colliding with Markelle Fultz. Preliminary x-rays revealed no fractures, which is good. Nick, how will Embiid's injury affect the Sixers' seeding in the East?
They have been, if you look at the on-off numbers, they have been two different teams this year with Joel Embiid on the court. And every other lineup imaginable with Joel Embiid off the court. So the fact that they were able to win this game, I know they were playing the Knicks. I know it was a home game.
Yeah, they were way up. Knicks came storming back.
I mean, when this injury happened early in the game, I thought, man, like this is a loss for Philly. In a game where, by the way, they're trying to catch Cleveland. Cleveland was en route to a win. They ended up getting the win. I don't think Philadelphia is a heavy favorite or a favorite even over anyone in the league except for the bottom five teams when Embiid is out. And the seeding does matter for them. They could catch Cleveland. They don't want to fall in the East where it's all compacted basically from 3 to 6. You don't want to fall to the 6 line face Cleveland in the first round. Like, the seeding matters. This could be significant for them.
There's good news coming out of it.
Yes.
He did pass through the concussion protocol, so that was good to know. He's got probably a little scar on his face. Like I continue to tell you, those basketball players aren't as tough as Nick thinks they are, but I think he's going to be all right. And it was nice how they responded. They've won 8 in a row now. They haven't won 8 in a row since 15 years, I think.
Yeah,
significant for that team to be able to win without him being on the court. And I'm glad it's just a facial contusion.
Absolutely.
To the team 2 spots ahead of the Sixers, the Celtics, they beat the Jazz last night on a last-second incredible play. Jaylen Brown Watch it right here, nailing the three with fractions of a second left. Brown had a 21 points. Celtics have now won five in a row. Chris, how do they continue to get it done without Kyrie?
Man, they play defense. They play hard. If you watch them play, they are very, very consistent. They don't have the athletes some other teams like Cleveland have. But they decide, because Brad Stevens, it's important to them. The coaches, they make sure no matter who's on the court, they're going to play. And Tatum and Jaylen, they have developed. Those are some of the reasons why they've been able to maintain this level. But this was a tightly contested game. Brad Stevens, they get a timeout at the end. Brad Stevens calls up a brilliant play. They dribble drive into the lane, kick it out to the wing. Utah overreacts. He kicks it to an open Jaylen Brown to knock it down before the but their coach, their ability to play defense is the reason why they've been able to stay consistent without their best player.
And Tatum and Jaylen Brown are exceptional athletes, but those were the only plus athletes they had on the court last night. It wasn't just no Kyrie, no Al Horford. Obviously, they haven't had Gordon Hayward. Marcus Smart's not playing. They were with, aside from Brown and Tatum,
the Morris twin was out.
Marcus Morris was out. Like, I mean, they were without, what, five of their top seven guys, and they beat one of the hottest teams in the league in Utah. They finished the game on a 9-0 run. They're down six with about 90 seconds remaining. They win the game. If there was any question about who the NBA coach of the year is, last night was further evidence. It is Brad Stevens.
Oh, yeah, you can't give it Houston.
What?
They got 61 wins. Don't get carried away, bro.
That's a good
Houston
conversation.
Houston can't win every award.
For another time.
But their coach has been the best.
Oh, you're okay.
Nuts? Did you hear me say I'm nuts?
I don't want to say you're nuts because I would have him say.
How many times have teams won more than 65 games? You taught me that yesterday.
20 times.
Oh, he ain't coach of the year.
All 20 haven't won coach of the year, CC.
So the video you're looking at is not with the
I don't know why you're
NBA
trying to get
coach.
Back in the grace with people in Boston.
I'm not trying. I've been saying this
doing,
about Brad Stevens
you're doing
all
something.
Year.
You're
I've been saying this. Sorry.
The NFL, thanks. The league is examining eliminating kickoffs to cut down on injuries. They've already moved touchbacks to the 25-yard line in an attempt to decrease the urge to bring the ball out of the end zone, but the league says data shows that injuries are still prevalent on kickoffs. CC, would getting rid of kickoffs be good for the game of football?
It wouldn't hurt the game, because when you talk about the adjustment that they've made as far as the game being safer, this is the most dangerous play in football. Studies have shown that a concussion is five times more likely to happen on a kickoff than any other play in the NFL. So I wouldn't be surprised they tinkered with the extra point, moving it back to finally adopting that as part of the game. Fans got used to it. Fans would get used to not kicking the ball off and teams starting at their 25-yard line. And you could actually say that the league, what they said, they backed it up with the rules that we want the game safer.
Listen, my initial reaction when they first started floating the idea of getting rid of the kickoff was, I hate that idea. That's just because I don't like change. Like, you're right. It wouldn't really affect, especially with the way they've made it to where now you get the ball at the 25. It's so rare you see a kick return touchdown anyway anymore because teams are taking knees. My only question would be this. If they did get rid of it, would that also eliminate the onside kick? Or would you, it obviously would eliminate the surprise onside kick, but would you still, you would have to, I think, still be allowed to say, hey,
yes,
we're not giving you the 25, we're doing an onside kick. I think that still has to be a
part
of the game.
Yes, you can't take away teams' ability to come back. And
right.
An onside kick, I believe, will always be a part of the game.
Right, as long as that's the case, I don't have a problem with this at all.
All right, it's that time of the show when we try and guess how a quarterback will do in his third year in the league. It's always a fun time. Today we start with Dak Prescott, first season, darling of the league, NFL Offensive Rookie of the Year. Second season, struggle city, exposed without Ezekiel Elliott, and a lot of questions surrounding his talent. Entering season number three, what will we get from Dak Prescott? Here's Cowboys CEO Stephen Jones on his quarterback.
I think he's the key. You know, at the end of the day, he's a big part of it. And it all starts with him. He's the trigger guy. And, you know, I think we can do some things to help him more. You know, I think Dak's a guy that's a little different than Tony, probably more like Troy in terms of the passing game. You know, he wants, you know, precise routes. He wants to throw the ball, you know, on time to areas. And whereas Tony would improvise a little more, not that Dak can't improvise, but, no, I think Dak is a little more disciplined in terms of wanting the receivers to be good route runners and be where they're supposed to be.
So, Cece, that's an interesting comparison, saying Dak is more like Troy Aikman than Tony Romo. What do you think?
I can understand what Steven's talking about, because Tony, he grew up kind of a miniature Brett Favre, where he was very, very good when things weren't on schedule, when things broke down in the pocket. He was a better athlete than people anticipated, and he could throw on the run. You know, that's not an indictment on Dak when you say that he's more like Troy Aikman. Now, I'm glad I listened to the words, because when he first said he's like Troy Aikman, I was like, what's he like him? They get dressed in the same locker. They've got the star on their helmet, because I don't see the similarities. Now he talks about how he likes the game to be played, where Dak is, even though he came from the system in Mississippi State, he's a pure drop back passer. He likes timing. He likes to go throw in the windows. Those are the types of things that Troy Aikman like. But from a skill set standpoint, doesn't have the skill set that Troy Aikman have. I just must say that. His delivery, his windup is a little bit slower than Troy's. His ability to be able to throw the ball deep down the field, he doesn't have that ability to Troy. Troy's deep ball, Troy's deep comebacks on the outside, they'll throw across the middle on timing, being fearless of throwing the ball in the coverage and knowing that he had the arm talent to be able to get it there. Those are things that Troy Aikman, that Dak does not have. Now, can Dallas do some things that Stephen Jones mentioned around him offensively to be able to help him out? But the overall mentality is a little more like Troy, of just, I want a system. I want to throw to areas. I want my guys to be able to get open. I'm not going to ad-lib as much as Tony Romo. So with that part, I agree with what Stephen said.
I tried to listen closely to what he said there about the style in which Dak is, the precise.
Were you listening closely, because you know I listen real quick?
Absolutely. No. 100% on something like this, no question about it. And one of the words he used were precise, on time to areas. And I thought about you, actually, when I heard this before the show, when you were describing Dez and the jerseys. We were talking about Dez and the route tree, and you're everyone this offseason, when they talk about Dez, is focused on, oh, he's going to have more routes, different routes to run. He's going to diversify his route tree. You have been much more focused on, how about the routes you're already running? Run them better. Get a better release off the line of scrimmage. Mm-hmm. Make it clear to your young quarterback that you are going to be open. So hearing you say that, then it seemed to me Stephen Jones is, in different words, saying a similar thing. Not about Dez, but about what Dak needs.
Yes.
That Dak, when I hear that, what he's saying is Dak needs to know early, mm-hmm. are you going to be A, where you're supposed to be, and B, are you going to have a window, created a window, where I can fit the ball in? So the question I have for you is, if I'm hearing that correctly, and that's obviously what you believe that will help Dak out, what is the type, what is the thing, what are the things the wide receivers can do to help Dak out, or the offensive coordinator can do to help Dak out, when he's talking about wide receivers running good routes and throwing to areas rather than the Romo style, which was, I might run around. Hey, you initially were running a comeback. Now you're just going deep on a scramble drill. That's not Dak's game.
Right. They don't do a lot of things where they get the ball out of Dak's hand quickly and the wide receiver is able to make a run or to be able to face up the defense. If we watch New England, New England gets rid of the ball faster than anyone else. Now, they don't have the best athletes, but they've come up with a scheme that they can get the ball to guys on the run. In the National Football League, you can't keep dropping back and throwing the ball to wide receivers that have their back to the defense. You need to be able to catch them on the run so they can get yards after the catch. Dallas does not do a great job as far as yards after the catch, so they don't have a lot of things that are designed to get the ball out to them quickly and to be able to make yards. And they don't have a great deep passing game. I'm talking about well thought out, where you have someone drag over the middle that suck up the safety, and then you sneak a guy deep behind them. You don't see them. Their deep passing is, okay, Dez, we're going to throw you a ball jump down ball. The sideline, and we want you to win a 50-50 jump ball. And that's not a plan.
I want to follow up real quick. Because when you talk about getting the ball out quickly, typically you wouldn't think about what we saw Philly do, the RPO stuff, because that is slow developing. But what I did see with the RPO stuff was when they made the decision on the run-pass option to pass the ball, once the decision is made,
yes,
then
that
it's
quick
fast.
Option, yes.
Then, it's
then it becomes a West Coast offense.
And a lot of those are drag or crossing routes where it could be an 18-yard completion where the ball traveled 4 yards in the air.
Right. And this is what they try to do. On the RPOs, the quarterback is behind the center in the shotgun. They have the back off to the left. And the easiest way to run an RPO is have the back fake a sweep going to the right. And in the process, the quarterback putting the ball in his pocket, he sees that linebacker right there. Once that linebacker moves, then I would put Dez or someone else on a quick slant. That's what they did with Nick Foles in the Vikings game, NFC Championship, and definitely what they did with him in the Super Bowl. So, yeah, that is a great thing. That should be good at that. But that's what you pay offensive coaches for, to come up with different schemes to be able to maximize his ability. It took Doug Peterson a few weeks to get to Nick Foles to get him into a system that he was comfortable, but they went right back to what he had had success when he was the starter there. So good point there.
I was going to say the same thing about the sweep, but you said it first, so now I don't need to say it. So you guys heard
right.
that.
The RPO?
The RPO, all of it. Oh, everywhere.
The quarterback, he's in the shotgun.
The shotgun. Obviously, he's not getting you move this way,
right,
4 yards in the air, but it was really like 18. All right, let's move on quickly. Roll the video so we can just keep talking. Hey, 2017 was the year of the touchdown celebration. I don't care if you were bowling or dancing or barbecuing. Whatever your hobby, the Steelers probably acted it out in the end zone. The Steelers players, big end zone celebration fans. Steelers head coach, not so much. Mike Tomlin said, quote, "I just think it takes away from the game. It's not a good look for young people. Young people aren't allowed to celebrate in that way, so why should we?" Interesting. CeCe, where do you fall on this?
When they first changed it, I was like, oh, no, because the wide receivers, the reason why they put the restriction on the celebration. And then going through the season, I started seeing how guys who would never be in the end zone celebrating, how it made teams in the year of where guys were protesting. To me, I thought this was refreshing because I think it brought the teams together. I was able to see some of the personalities of other guys that I don't see. I understand Mike Tomlin. You know, he's a hard-nosed football player. He played football at William & Mary. He grew up learning the game the right way, mentored by Tony Dungy. I can understand why he would say that. But the NFL and the players and the character of the players, they won me over. I saw more positive things coming out of that. The Vikings with the leapfrog, the Eagles with the...
The duck, duck, goose. They had all those, like, fun things.
The Steelers played CeeLo in the end zone. The Steelers, like, they got
so,
the...
So for me, the overall win was bigger. Then I saw a few things that I wasn't proud of.
But and your point about getting the offensive lineman involved is one I hadn't thought about and really cool. Because under the old rules, you were allowed to celebrate. It was more restricted, but it had to be individualized. You could not do anything with a teammate. But when I heard Mike Tomlin talking about this, you told a story once about Denny Green talking to you and about how your actions were going to reflect upon him. And that's how you had to carry that responsibility, not just because you were the best player on the team, the Vikings were a prominent team, but also because Denny Green was one of the few black coaches in the league at the time, and they want to always, there's sometimes a little slightly different standards.
There is no doubt.
And does this guy, is he too much of a player's coach? Does he have control of his roster? And that is something, some of it fair, some of it unfair, we hear about Mike Tomlin. Like, does he have control of his guys? So I love the celebrations. I think one of the reasons you appreciate the way Barry Sanders did things is because there was Deion Sanders doing things differently.
Right.
Like the diversity of personality. But I understand why Mike Tomlin might, on a personal level, be worried how this reflects upon him. You understand that people might be saying, because the Steelers were the most celebrating team out there this year,
yes,
and that whether or not the general public thinks that's an, I would say, unfair, but an indictment on
time. And as a defensive coach, I think that we saw more things coming from defensive players. The shot we have right here, that's of the Pittsburgh defense, over your shoulder there, Nick. The electric slide by Philadelphia, their whole secondary, whole defense doing that. Man, we saw some really good things coming out of, with the normal celebration rule, we didn't think it was special teams players and wide receivers for the most part. So it was nice and I thought refreshing to see some of these defenders being able to be involved in the celebration
because
also.
There's a difference between showboating and celebrating. And when you could see these guys, which means they practiced it during the week, they got together. They didn't just nail it on the first time. They're like, no, you didn't do that part right. When we hide and seek, you have to do it this way. And when you see that, it goes against everything that we sort of mocked the Steelers for, all the, like, infighting and whatnot. It just made it seem like it brought them together.
And as we got into the playoffs, wild card round, people still celebrating. Divisional round, celebrating a little bit.
Yeah.
NFC Championship?
No.
No, sir. AFC Championship? No, sir. Super Bowl? Not even thinking about it. So I think that the players understood the magnitude as the season went on.
All right, we're going to take a break. Coming up, Kevin Durant lashes out again in a big decision for one of the NBA's best players. Next on First Things First. Surprise, that's so unlike Kevin Durant to do anything that's...